Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to today's seminar in Ukrainian studies. My name is Emily Channell-Justice, and I'm the director of the Temerty Contemporary Ukraine program at the Ukrainian Research Institute at Harvard University. Today's seminar features my edited volume, which is entitled Decolonizing Queer Experience, LGBT plus narratives from Eastern Europe and Eurasia, which was released in 2020 from Lexington Books. Today's event highlights the chapters in the volume that are based on research in Ukraine, and we'll also discuss the book's framing and its contributions to the field. I'm really delighted to be joined today by three of the book's contributors. Vitaly Chernetsky is associate professor in the Department of Slavic Languages and Literatures at the University of Kansas. His vast research interests include Russian literature and culture, including film, theater, and visual arts, Ukrainian literature and culture, cultural aspects of globalization, postmodernism and postmodernity, and of course, gender studies and LGBT studies. He wrote the preface to our volume, Decolonizing Queer Experience. I'm also joined by Roman Leksikov, who is an early stage researcher who works in the intersection of criminology and gender and sexuality studies. He's originally from Ukraine and he finished his undergraduate studies at Tarashevchenko National University in Kyiv and pursued a master's degree at the University of Alberta in Canada. He's currently working as an analyst for the Ukrainian Center for Law and Crime Research and as an intervention worker in Montreal, Quebec. Tamar Shirinian is postdoctoral teaching associate at the University of Tennessee, Knoxville in the Department of Anthropology. She received her PhD in cultural anthropology with a certificate in feminist studies from Duke University in 2016. She has conducted ethnographic research among queer and feminist activists, as well as right-wing and anti-homosexual activists in the post-socialist Republic of Armenia. She co-wrote the introduction and contributed the chapter Queering Identity, Misrecognition as Performance and Refusal in Armenian LGBT Advocacy in Decolonizing Queer Experience. So our event will proceed as follows. First, we will have Tamar discuss the introduction of the book and its theoretical framework, and she'll draw a little bit from her own chapter and research as well. Then I will provide a brief description of the other chapters of the volume before delving a little more deeply into my own chapter. Then we'll hear Roman's presentation of his chapter, and Vitaly will conclude by placing the book in context and discussing its contributions to the field. Vitaly has agreed to write the Q&A portion of the event, so you may submit your questions to the chat box on YouTube and we will address as many of them as possible. Thank you so much to my guests for being here. I'm really thrilled to have this discussion and I'm going to turn it over to Tamar.
Hi, everybody. Thank you all for being here today. Thank you to the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute for the invitation, to all of the staff that worked to make this event possible, to all of the authors who contributed to this project, and to Emily for the book. As the title of the book makes clear, Decolonizing Queer Experience makes use of a decolonial approach. Decolonization is a contested framework. Scholars who work on settler colonialism have problematized the metaphorical uses of the concept, insisting that decolonization be reserved to questions about land, territory, autonomy, and sovereignty, lest it make possible a set of evasions or settler moves to innocence that problematically attempt to reconcile settler guilt and complicity and rescue settler futurity. Eve Tuck and Kevin Yang have further problematized the tensions between Franz Fanon's canonical Wretched of the Earth and Paulo Freire's Pedagogy of the Oppressed, which they see as a response to Fanon. Freire, Tuck and Yang insist, makes a right turn away from Fanon's work, which always positioned the work of liberation in the particularities of colonization in the specific structural and interpersonal categories of native and settler. Decolonizing Queer Experience does not make any direct reference to either Fanon or Freire. This is not, I think, because the book does not take seriously earlier visions of decolonization, nor because it has nothing to do with this tension, but because the book opens up new arenas for thinking about how colonialism operates in this relatively new world of post-socialist Eastern Europe and Eurasia, as well as how tensions and relations in decolonial struggles have emerged there. The book's main themes on experience, performance, performativity, and identity are not necessarily in regard to land, but sovereignty is at the heart of the questions that the contributors in the volume raise. Neither are these questions in regard to pedagogy explicitly, yet knowing, unknowing, being, and experiencing are very much within the assemblage of ideas that the book seeks to explore. As Vitaly Chernetsky points out in the book's preface, much of the debate about colonialism and decolonization that exists within critical inquiry assumes the world as divided between the first world and the third world, and has not bothered to think about the complexities of these lines of thought within what was once called the second world. Decolonizing Queer Experience is not the first text to examine the cleavages between post-socialism and post-colonialism, certainly, but it does offer brave new interstices of examination. What would decolonization of queer experience in the post-socialist world look like? For a panel at the American Anthropological Association, from which the book emerged, Emily Channell-Justice brilliantly offered the framework of performance and performativity as the realms from which we might begin exploring this question. The chapters in the volume seek to provide answers through a multiplicity of scales, methods, and interpretations of colonialism, as well as grounded decolonial approaches embedded in citational practices and the contestations of the meanings behind those forms of citationality. How do post-socialist actors perform, materialize, and contest non-heteronormative identities in queer politics? And also critically for the book, how do they perform queer critique? How are performatives of gender and sexuality and of critique spaces of decolonial struggle? Working against the notion of a socialist or pre-socialist invisibility, some of these chapters use a methodology of unearthing otherwise lost paths to make sense of contemporary epistemological and ontological colonialism and possibilities of resistance. Other authors in the volume further push on these lines of inquiry of how the queer politics and the categories around which they converge in the West are constantly interrupted in the East, problematizing not only a Western global gay imaginary taking hold of the East, but the terms of queer politics in the West itself. Through the funding of local non-governmental organizations and projects, incorporating local activists into global, largely Europe and US-based networks, and the use of and availability of language and discourse pertaining to proper identity, proper LGBT politics, excuse me, and proper sexual practice, knowledge from the West about what non-heterosexuality was about and how it could produce a viable politics reached the East and has been incorporated into individual, collective, and organizational practice since the 1990s. Alongside this form of import or export, depending on how one looks at it, the queer critique of normative LGBT politics following homonormative and homonationalist frameworks, which problematize the ways in which homonormativity aligns with capitalist as well as nationalist interests, has also been taken up by queer activists in the post-socialist world to challenge how local organizations, through their ties to global networks, work to discipline queer behavior. While these queer critiques perform a decolonial approach to queer politics, they might be seen as further colonizing local spaces by borrowing frameworks that are even more entrenched in US and European discourse and experience than the homonormative practices under critique, as Roman Leksikov has argued. Queer critique in the post-socialist world thus presents a quagmire. Caught between the colonialism of Western discourse and practice, as well as the colonialism of forms of critiquing Western discourse and practice, what is needed is a new framework through which to think about how queerness in the post-socialist world might offer new ways of interrogating the politics of sexuality. This new decolonial framework is what the various chapters in Decolonizing Queer Experience offer. To understand these ways of offering queer critique, we might turn to two frameworks of performance and performativity that have already been thought in the context of post-socialism and in the context of marginalized queerness. That is, between what Alexei Yurchak offers as over-identification in his exploration of late socialist forms of politics and critique, and what Jose Esteban Munoz offers as disidentification amongst queers of color and third world queers in the US. Over-identification, or stjob, refers to a kind of parody of authority, an authoritative discourse that relied on over-identification with it rather than an oppositional critique. This was, according to Yurchak, a way of both working within as well as challenging a hyper-normalized authoritarian discourse that relied on performative dimensions, fitting the form of authoritarian socialist ideology, but left open various spaces of nuance in the constitutive meanings of ideology. There are two sets of opposing discourse that have become hyper-normalized in the post-socialist era. First is the Western liberal discourse, dependent on a global gay identity and the politics of visibility on which this liberation rests. This is the discourse in which all, no matter what geopolitical context, are now expected to speak, but often do speak. Second is the illiberal discourse that comes out of the post-socialist region, the second authoritative and hyper-normalized discourse that frames the worlds of Eurasia as belonging to another civilization that prioritizes the family, the church, and the nation above individual rights, is also in some ways a mirror image of the West's discourse about itself. And if, in other words, it is through Orientalist imaginaries that the West has produced the East as backward, the East has in many ways taken this up for itself as a self-orientalizing imaginary of an illiberal civilization. The chapters in Decolonizing Queer Experience each point to the ways in which within performative dimensions, there are various new spaces of challenge and nuance within the constitutive meanings of these over-identificatory performatives. Taking on identities that seem to be a direct assimilation into a global gay politics of visibility, queer actors in the post-socialist world challenge these categories on their level of meaning and effect in a post-socialist context. Queer political actors also offer a nuanced critique of illiberalism in a homophobic East, pointing to layers of meaning and possibility in Eastern European folk cultures, Eastern European and Eurasian folk cultures, post-socialist public life, and pre-socialist and socialist archival unearthings. The chapters, in other words, decolonize our abilities to see beyond and through authoritative discourse. Through separating out the performative and constitutive dimensions of performance, thus, new revelations about queer practices, politics, and critique become apparent. While over-identification offers one way of looking for a decolonial struggle within queer experience, disidentification offers another. For Munoz, for some bodies, those which are minoritized or marginalized by heteronormativity, white supremacy, and misogyny, identification emerges only as disidentification, as, in his words, identities in difference from a failed interpolation within the dominant public sphere. While post-socialist queer actors certainly form these minoritized and marginalized spaces of heteronormativity, white supremacy, and misogyny, there are also parts of worlds that are marginalized through rhetorics and ideologies of pathologized political economy and culture. As Shannon Woodcock has suggested, the very logic of post-socialism as a concept points to a context that is still seeking to come out of a historical pathology, a backwardness that is never quite over, a closetedness that is consistently in the process of movement out into the real world of politics, the real world where liberation is possible. Disidentification, thus, offers a way of reading in between the claims of identification for what is actually being challenged, pushed against, negotiated, and contested as a me, but not quite. In identifying, or perhaps even over-identifying, with a global gay imaginary, queer post-socialist actors and activists also point to these not-quites, and thus to the possibility of a complete, of the impossibility of a complete usurpation of grounded post-socialist experiences through Western forms of politics making. Through disidentification, it becomes clear that it is the inherent colonialism, racism, internalized liberalism, neoliberalism, and a consumer-based attachment to politics that Western gay activism's approach to Eastern Europe and Eurasia can never quite be complete. Instead, these projects produce gaps and spaces for new constitutive dimensions of performance, new meanings, new challenges, new identities, and new politics. It is in these ways that decolonizing queer experience makes way for a queer theory that does not rely on an American studies-informed queer theory. The book is a particularly post-socialist queer theory. However, this does not mean that the theory that the book produces should be ghettoized within the post-socialist world. This, I think, is critical. Any scholar, activist, queer performer, or anyone interested in the question of subjectivity and the political, really, should take what decolonizing queer experience offers to think about the questions of identity, global and local imagined geographies, queerness, and performativity seriously. While situated in Eurasia and Eastern Europe, these chapters, each individually and read together, offer critical challenges to hypernormalize discourse that continue to guide queer studies as it is being practiced and conceived of in many places throughout the world. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that wonderful introduction, Tamar. And I will just reiterate quickly, before introducing the chapters individually, what Tamar mentioned about this book coming out of a panel at the American Anthropological Association in 2018, which Tamar kindly served as discussant on that panel, and Roman presented a version of this chapter. Maybe you presented something else. I at this point, it was a few years ago. But I would just say, you know, those two, that discussion at that panel really shaped not only my own research, but also how this book came about in terms of thinking about what, you know, making a contribution that incorporated perspectives from around the post-Soviet region, post-socialist region, at the same time that it pushed back against many of the common ways of studying LGBT communities in the post-socialist world, which is, I think, its greatest contribution. So I will quickly introduce the chapters themselves. I'm going to go ahead and share. I made a slide with the chapters on it so that you could maybe see a little bit more easily who the contributors are. So you can see here that the book is divided into three sections, and each of those sections sort of play a little bit on well-known contributions to queer theory that come out of both the Western canon and not. So the first section is called The Categories Themselves, which, if you have worked within the realm of queer theory, you have probably read something by David Valentine. So he has a chapter or an article entitled The Categories Themselves, but his longer work, Imagining Transgender, was very influential in my thinking and has certainly shaped queer theory in anthropology. And the influence of his work, I think, is present throughout the volume. So this section features a kind of engagement with the idea of the categories and how they've translated themselves across space and time. The first chapter by Tessa Kontler explores the intersection of trans theory and activism with decoloniality, and they use post-Yugoslav art projects to illustrate the pushback against Western-dominated queer theory. And Tamar Shirinian's chapter in this section focuses on the queering of identity production among LGBT plus people in Armenia, which again challenges the domination of Euro-American terms and categories. And I might also state here that I'm condensing chapters into single sentences that doesn't really encompass the breadth of their contributions. So if you're in the audience and would like to ask Tamar something more specifically about her research in this chapter, I encourage that. It's a really, really fantastic chapter. And finally, in this section is Sinat Sultanaliyeva's chapter, which considers notions of good and bad girls in Kyrgyzstan as it relates to ideas of shame and family expectations among LGBT-identified people in Kyrgyzstan. The second section is called Queer in Public, which kind of evokes Laurie Essig's 1999 Queer in Russia, A Story of Self, Sex, and the Other. This is one of the earliest contributions from the region in US academia, and Essig kind of uses this book to argue against the notion that a communal LGBT rights-based activist movement should automatically develop an independent Russia. And this book is also kind of known for using very creative methodologies. It's a really interesting read. So if you are kind of unfamiliar with the region, I do recommend this book. It was very influential for me when I first read it in graduate school. And so that was part of the motivation to continue to evoke this book in this section. So the chapters here draw on Essig's engagement with public space to think about how people have been queer or LGBT identified in public over space and time. So it includes my own chapter, which I'll talk about here in a little bit, which uses the example of Kyiv's pride parades to explore the connections between leftist activism and LGBT plus movements. Then we have Firuza Aripova's chapter, which investigates the impact of anti-sodomy legislation in Soviet Latvia from the 1960s to the 1980s and shows how gay men saw themselves within the homophobic Soviet state. And then finally, Roman Leksikov's chapter, which I'll talk about in just a little while, explores how LGBT plus people relate to police and penitentiaries. And what I think is especially unique about his chapter is that it draws from the North American and Ukrainian context. So it's really transnational, which I think is important for the contribution that the volume's making. Finally, the last section, Decolonizing Queer Performance, draws less from a specific particular work and engages more with the important role of performance, bodies, and performativity in queer theory. And I should add also that perhaps obviously the themes of each of the sections are not discrete entities themselves. The chapters overlap, they draw from many of the same works, and they are in conversation with one another as well. So for us, Zhanar Sakharbayeva's chapter uses Kazakh folklore to find the potential for gendered transgressions. And this chapter most specifically engages with the idea of Russian colonialism in a unique way. Carlos Verdint and Janis Ozolins explore the life stories of two queer performers in rural Latvia, drawing queer theory out of the urban spaces where it is typically assumed to exist most robustly. And finally, Polina Kislytsina's chapter argues that Russian LGBT plus people have varied experiences and relationships with religion, which she explores through life histories. And so I think you can see from the chapters here that the volume really tries to move away from, well, I mean, of course, the context of violence and repression is extremely important in the region. The contributions of the chapters are all trying to tell another part of the story, and especially push back against some of the assumptions that we make about the region and what LGBT experience is in the region. So now I'm going to turn to my own chapter, which is entitled LGBT plus Rights, European Values, and Radical Critique, Leftist Challenges to LGBT plus Mainstreaming in Ukraine. And this chapter explores the intersection of LGBT rights with Europeanization and leftist politics. It is framed around the question of gay rights as part of Ukraine's European aspirations, and it uses the example of pride parades, especially in Kyiv, to connect LGBT rights to the Euromaidan mobilizations of 2013 and 2014. So it really addresses the question, are safer pride parades and increasing LGBT plus activism in Ukraine a legacy of Euromaidan? I ask these questions at the same time that I look at the intersection between LGBT plus communities and leftist activists in Ukraine. And I take this angle because of my earliest research with student activists who were affiliated with leftist political perspectives and who I found out were early allies of the LGBT movement in Ukraine. This isn't at all to say that LGBT activism comes out of the left in Ukraine, and indeed part of my continuing research is looking at the ways that leftist LGBT identified activists have moved away from or even split with some of the mainstream LGBT NGOs and organizations. That's kind of a longer story that's currently happening. But I came to this project precisely because I wanted to understand how and why leftists felt that they were natural allies of the burgeoning LGBT movement. And in recent years, I've also found that leftist LGBT plus activists have presented sound criticism of mainstream rights-based LGBT activism. So by this, I mean that some activists see a disconnect between the visible kinds of recognition of LGBT plus people that have become more common in Ukraine and then the actual lived reality of being an LGBT plus person for whom it's also often still unsafe to be out in public. So to give just a little bit of background, I do want to talk about the current state of LGBT community in Ukraine. And as I stated earlier, the dominant narratives for at least the past two decades are about oppression, repression, which are of course real and important in the context of this research. So for instance, you might have seen or followed the stories of the homosexual propaganda laws in the Russian Duma and similar laws that have been proposed in Ukraine as recently as 2018. Although I also want to note here that in 2015, Ukraine passed anti-discrimination legislation that includes protections around sexuality. These were part of the legislation package related to Ukraine's accession, European Union Association Agreement. In the 2010s, though, news coverage of LGBT pride parades in the region focused largely on violence and counter-protest, and it's not really until around 2017 and 2018 that we start to see push coverage of pride parades that focuses on the parades as celebration, pushback to conservative politics in the region. But we also know that the presence of a pride parade does not mean tolerance for homosexuality has necessarily increased. So I've included this graphic in my PowerPoint for you to see the, it looks all across Europe. You can see a kind of general positive trend toward acceptance of homosexuality across Western and Northern Europe. You can see that the major decreases have been in Eastern Europe, and Russia and Ukraine have the lowest levels of acceptance of homosexuality. I don't know anything about how this poll was conducted and you know, who really did it. And I also, I'll speak a little bit about how there's really still kind of a dearth of research on this topic of acceptance and tolerance of LGBT people. So we really still, I think, need a lot more information based on what has happened since the 2015 legislation was passed. We don't really know if that legislation or if the greater presence of pride parades has actually changed the levels of tolerance. There's a couple of small surveys that I've looked at. A 2017 survey from the University of St. Gallen indexed social distance, which is a judgment of how close or far you feel from others. So this survey found that Ukrainians felt more distant from LGBT people than any other group of people. And that survey included people, the people whose distance was measured. They asked about racial and ethnic minorities, immigrants, people from different areas of Ukraine, displaced populations, and et cetera. And of all those populations, Ukrainians largely felt that the LGBT community was the furthest away from them, the most different. And then I have a few statistics from a small survey published in 2018, which showed that only 8.8% of people in Ukraine had so-called favorable attitudes toward LGBT people. At the same time, only 4.9% of respondents said that they counted LGBT people among their acquaintances. And another small survey taken among students in a Kyiv university said that people's attitudes in Ukraine were universally more positive if they had a gay or lesbian person among their family and friends. And I'll just add that that's the language of the survey. They asked about gay or lesbian people, not LGBT or queer, which is maybe, you know, a topic for the Q&A, the kind of terminology that we use here. But I think that, you know, this is really interesting because it shows that the more that people think that they know somebody from the LGBT community, the more inclined they are to advocate for acceptance and possibly tolerance as well. And this, I think, is an important trend. At the same time, we also know that there is an important counter narrative coming from far right and strong nationalist perspectives that suggests that homosexuality and LGBT identities are a threat to traditional family, traditional values in Ukraine. This argument is something that is structured similarly to arguments about feminism. They claim that feminism and gender equality ideologies threaten traditional family structures and therefore Ukraine itself. Organizations such as the right sector continually organize counter demonstrations to the pride parades in Kyiv. They call on social media, they use terms like Ukrainophobic, and they call participants of these parades, destroyers of the traditional Ukrainian family, was a terminology that they used before. And here I find parallel in the Russian context. Samuel Green and Graham Robertson used, they talk about the Russian context and the use of LGBT rights claims as a threat to tradition, as a wedge issue. That's the term that they use that I find useful. It's a kind of idea that LGBT issues previously have been absent from mainstream political discussions, but people in power find that they become useful to think about, and they become useful to motivate people such as the far right to come out to the streets to support those in power, and to stir up support about traditional values. And I think this is very clearly happening in Ukraine as well. So what we end up finding is that people in Ukraine and Russia, and probably most of the other contexts in this volume, LGBT people continue to relate sexuality to the private sphere in order to protect themselves, even though this reinforces the marginalization of their claims to rights. So this is the context in which I ask the question, why did leftist activists feel compelled to support LGBT plus activism? And the marginalization of leftist activists is part of my other broader research topic, and I'm happy to talk about that more in the discussion, but I'm really curious as to what brought these threads together. I don't think it was inevitable. And so I want to talk here about bringing a quote from a leftist activist. This is from an interview that took place in April of 2014. This is a male activist who is kind of talking out his leftist views, and he says, basically, I am of leftist views, but the spectrum of left is really big, and I only became politicized so strongly in the last year and a half, and especially during the time of the events on Maidan. But to what level and which direction exactly, I haven't finished deciding, but definitely left. There's a big influence that I took part and continue to take part in the last 8 or 9 years in tolerance projects and informal education about tolerance and anti-discrimination. Maybe especially it was that the action for International Human Rights Day that made an impression on me at the end of 2012. There was an action against the law 8711, that's the so-called homosexual propaganda law, and human rights activists as well as student activists came, and there was a Nazi attack. And it became clear to me that leftists support human rights and anti-discrimination, while the ultra-right does not. On the one hand, it makes sense that the left is positioned as the opposite of the far right, as we can see here. And on the other hand, supporting LGBT plus communities just contributes more to leftist marginalization. But I like the way that this activist presents that LGBT plus rights are human rights, and the radical right and the state work together to repress human rights. And the timing of this is also important because it took the interview took place just after the Euromaidan protests turned violent and state repression resulted in a violent uprising. So kind of making that connection between state repression of human rights and far right repression of human rights makes sense in this context. So the leftist allies of the LGBT movement are presenting themselves as a political alternative that is more progressive than the current governing system. This activist also associated the radical right with unprovoked violence, a tactic that leftists and other progressive movements would not use. And he presented the use of violence as the opposite of respect for human rights. In discussing the far right attack on the demonstration against the gay propaganda laws, he said, just violence. It was not clear to me why they jumped us, why they used tear gas. There wasn't any kind of provocation, just an attack. So this use of violence is a key component of why leftists support LGBT activists, because the violence that the far right has used against leftists and LGBT community seems to them to come from the same position. And here I'll also talk just a little, and in the chapter I have a couple more examples of activists who participated in pride parades in Kyiv in 2015, and then started writing about that experience and why it was essential for them to participate in those protests. So here we have an image from the 2015 Pride Parade in Kyiv. And this was the first Pride Parade that took place. I guess they called it an equality march, just to be specific. This took place after Euromaidan. About 250 people joined the march. It was protected by nearly 500 city police officers, which you can see in this image. The radical right-wing activists that came harassed and attacked the march. They injured several protesters and several police officers as well. And all the other events that were supposed to take place during this Equality March week were canceled. But despite the fact that this happened, many leftists kind of considered this a success, and they felt like the fact that the police officers actually protected the parade and protected the marchers rather than siding with the far right, that actually showed a significant shift in perceptions of protest and activism that came out of the Euromaidan protests. So typically when leftist activists tried to support this type of event, you know, the police was unlikely to show up and support the protests. And so one leftist activist kind of connected this protest experience with a sort of general idea about emancipation from the constraints of capitalism, that kind of connected the LGBT rights struggle in Ukraine with the fundamental ideas about leftist politics. And this person who was attacked and beaten up by the right-wing people who came to the march, he felt like it was important, despite the attack, despite the violence, to speak out in support of this type of movement. So his quote is on the bottom here. He says, "The exclusion and creation of stigmatized minorities has been a common method of the existence of a capitalist world system since its inception. Today, the artificial stigmatization, criminalization, and social exclusion of social groups, migrants, national and religious minorities, LGBT people, is perhaps the most important way of legitimizing the barriers between the exploited of the capitalist system, both between different countries and within each country. Only real effective solidarity between all the excluded and the exploited, whoever that may be, is the only guarantee of a successful struggle for real emancipation and overcoming the capitalist system of human exploitation by man." So we know that since 2015, Kyiv's pride parades have become major events. They've been protected by large numbers of police. They've had institutional support from groups such as Amnesty International. This is an image from the 2017 parade, and you can see that there was a large presence of police to protect the march. There was a counter demonstration by far right protesters, but there was no mass violence against participants. This parade featured some 5,000 police that were mobilized for the event. But the connection here with the left is that the many leftist LGBT identified people still feel like these pride parades are kind of indicating a safety and an attitude that doesn't actually exist in day-to-day in Ukraine. The right wing still promotes the idea that LGBT plus people threaten traditional gender norms and family structures. So the successful pride parade with rainbows and drag queens who are protected by police makes Ukraine appear to be more accepting of LGBT plus citizens than it actually is. So when I was talking with one leftist feminist activist who attended this parade in 2017, she said, you know, this is great. It was a great experience, but you know, we can do that here when there are thousands of other people in a police cordon, but we can't do it every day. And to her, it really kind of hid the fact that violence was still such an important marker of her everyday experience. And here, just to, in my kind of final statement from the chapter, I want to draw a little bit from queer theorist Jasbir Poor's idea of homo nationalism, in order to kind of help me critique the role of pride parades in hiding the lack of real change in attitudes toward LGBT plus people in Ukraine. So Poor argues that homo nationalism is, quote, "a facet of modernity and a historical shift marked by the entrance of some homosexual bodies as worthy of protection by nation states, a constitutive and fundamental reorientation of the relationship between the state, capitalism, and sexuality," end quote. And in other words, certain countries try to present themselves as more modern, more successfully modern, because they protect certain groups of homosexuals, so usually white cisgendered men and women, through things like the legalization of same-sex marriage. And these types of protections that make them look modern at the same time belie an intentional ignoring of, for instance, Black trans bodies for people who don't have the same rights as other LGBT people. And in the example of Ukraine, I draw from this to show that we do not necessarily see that only some LGBT plus bodies are worth protecting, but what we see is that all LGBT plus bodies are only sometimes worth protecting. So only when Ukraine is trying to make a certain claim about European identity through pride parades that are trying to show that Ukraine is following the norms of European democracies, then are LGBT plus bodies worth protecting. And this is something that leftist critics are pointing out. The pride parades are not representative of the actual lived experiences of LGBT plus people in Ukraine. The pride parades are an institutionalized recognition of LGBT plus rights, but leftist activists are not actually convinced that these types of events help end discrimination and marginalization. Because leftist interest in LGBT causes is intimately connected to their commitment to the liberation of all oppressed people, leftists are intensely critical of these surface measures that only represent equality, but do little to concretely support LGBT people in their everyday lives. I'm going to stop here. I do end the chapter with a little bit more optimism. And so we can talk about kind of more positive steps that activists and others are making in this context in the Q&A. But for now, I'll say thank you for listening and I'll turn the floor over to Roman.
Good afternoon, everyone. Do you hear me? Awesome. Thank you. I'm really thrilled and honored to be among you and to deliver this talk today. I do realize that I'm definitely the youngest and the least experienced researcher at today's panel. And it really, really excites me to talk to such advanced and reputable scholars like you all, but it also makes me a little bit nervous. First of all, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to Emily and everyone who showed up today and made it all possible. And Emily, thank you once again that you made it all come true. I know very often that the expression of gratitude is a rather formal thing, but I want to highlight that my personal gratitude is super sincere and comes from the bottom of my heart, since I know how much effort like you put into pulling the bloom together, editing our articles, publishing it and stuff like that. Once again, like a big human thank you for you and all our participants today. And also, like, it's been already over a year that I haven't done like any presentation in English, because like I work principally rather in like either in French or in Ukrainian, and I feel like my language skills have been kind of corroded, so please don't judge my mistakes in terms of grammar or pronunciation. Right after I have submitted my article to the volume, the new wave of the protest against police brutality has started in the United States in response to the one more horrible homicide committed by the police against an African-American, George Floyd. But even though the American social context in terms of criminal justice is very specific and seriously differs from the multiplicity of Canadian, European, post-Soviet, Latin American contexts, that powerful movement of resistance against state violence triggered a lot of discussions and activism concerning the relationship between the police and the marginalized communities way much beyond the United States. And it has become one more discursive layer that has been added on the top of previous discussions about the police accountability for the state-initiated and state-sanctioned violence against LGBTI communities, even today, and about the possibility of police presence in queer spaces and rightfulness of any sort of collaboration between the police and the queer communities. And here I would like to highlight, for example, what Emily has said right about the Ukrainian discussion, why the, like, that, let's say, like some leftist activists would like to see state protection on the everyday basis rather than like 1 year time. However, it triggers another discussion, because there is another part of, let's say, like leftist queer activists who would argue that accomplishing state support in terms of policing and police protection should be not the ultimate goal, and could only damage the future and the well-being of queer people and queer communities. And basically my paper aimed to demonstrate that those like two polar approaches we observe today, aka, let's say, on the one hand, the police as the hope of LGBT people for safety and justice, and on the other hand, the police as an inherently institutionally homophobic and transphobic phenomenon, oversimplifies social reality, because, for instance, there are examples of how different criminal justice institutions may treat LGBTI plus people differently in the same society and at the same time. And my data from Ukraine show that complexity of attitudes of queer people, victims of hate crimes, to the criminal justice system, the evolution of queer narratives and imagination of the criminal justice and how different outcomes of interaction between queer people and the criminal justice institutions might appear under different settings. First and foremost, I was interested to shed some light on the attitudes of Ukrainian queer people who fell victim to hate crimes toward the criminal justice system. How do they perceive the role of criminal justice system and its institutions in the process of sexual citizenship acquisition, or vice versa, the construction and maintenance of structural homophobia and transphobia? How do the victims renegotiate their vision of the relationships between LGBTI people and the criminal justice system after victimization and collaboration with the police? What are the motivation of Ukrainian queer people to engage with the police and the judicial system? I put a specific emphasis on the issue of queer vision of the penitentiary system in contemporary Ukraine, exploring the presence and absence of cultural trauma post-Soviet queer people, might experience at the consequence of homophobic and transphobic politics of late Soviet and early post-Soviet carceral system and the police. And in this regard, I was concerned with establishing patterns of cultural trauma construction and their difference in relation to the similar queer political process in North American countries like Canada and the United States. I would say that the current process of the queer resentment towards police in North America may be theorized as the construction of cultural trauma and the emergence of the politics of memory in response to a widespread and systemic police mistreatment of queer people that was the reality of the North American cities until the early 2000s. And let's say the most recognized theorist of cultural trauma, cultural sociologist Jeffrey Alexander, argued that a surviving community begins the process of the cultural trauma construction after approximately one generation passes and after failing attempts to pursue so-called can-do mentality. And hence the timeline of ending systemic persecution of queer people by the criminal justice system largely coincides in North American societies and in Ukraine. I was wondering how this process is similar and how it differs given the contextual settings. I also tried, since like today we speak about discursive colonialism and decolonizing post-Soviet queer discourses, I also tried to pay specific attention to the let's say copy-paste effect, as I would say, of the mainstream North American queer criticism of police in post-Soviet settings that might be observed since approximately 2014 in Ukraine, because I would argue that it might be intellectually and politically irresponsible to engage Ukrainian queer communities in the same type of reasoning and thinking that dominates in the United States and Canada nowadays. Because even here in North America, I would like to critically examine why the queer criticism of the policing designates the police as individually responsible for structural violence against queer people, neglecting the other components of the structural violence. The discourse, as we can conclude from Alexandra, places responsibility on the police for the entire system of homophobic and transphobic structural violence. And this designation opens up myriad problematic questions. Let's say if queer pride politics aim to ban institutions that are actively engaged in structural violence against queer people in the past or present from being a part of the pride movement, why is it exclusively about the police and not about the healthcare system or religious organizations, which are still welcome in pride parades throughout the continent? And moreover, what I have concluded after some fieldwork, given the crucial differences between the socioeconomic origin and education level of police workers on the one side and healthcare or education workers on the other, my empirical data basically confirmed that the last ones have much more institutional will and agency in producing their own anti-queer politics at the same time as the police as an institution is way much more, legally limited and framed. Of course, I hope that it's clear that I by no means justify police violence against queer communities, but I would just like to nuance this discussion since rather we want it or we don't, police as the institution is strongly inscribed in the modern and capitalist society, and we have to keep researching it if we want to advance social justice. When I went to the field and started to collect data from my research, I was persuaded that this process of the cultural trauma building toward the police and the carceral system in Ukraine manifests itself to the same extent or even stronger than here in North America. However, the reality turned out to be slower and more comprehensive and complicated than I expected. Though it may seem like the majority of participants are too hopeful regarding the possibility of successful instrumentalization of the criminal justice system. Once again, here I would like to refer to Emily's example that she gave us in terms of like they still rely and they still believe that police should and is able to protect them on like day-to-day basis. It must be noted, however, that none of them expressed a belief in the potential of the Ukrainian criminal justice system to rehabilitate offenders and thus to eradicate the very roots of the anti-queer violence. And however, a lot of them believe that sentences and incarceration may be an effective tool of social change in terms of prevention of new offenses. Those same beliefs pushed a total majority of my participants to interact with the criminal justice system after experiencing violence. But I would call it the form of the cruel optimism if we refer to the theory created by Barton. And moreover, this cruel optimism toward the criminal justice system has been reinforced in the contemporary Ukrainian queer imaginary quite recently after the police reform that took place in 2015. And the queer vision and imagination of the new police has perfectly reflected the general social reaction that was shaped on the basis of binaries. They perceive and probably keep perceiving the old militia and the new police through the dichotomous dispositions of archaic versus modern, past versus future, Soviet versus European, and hence obscurantist versus tolerant and progressive, regressive versus protective. And many LGBTI people, as well as LGBT and human rights organizations, hoped that this reform would significantly improve the relationships of, like, between queer people and law enforcement institutions and would completely reshape practices of policing of homophobic and transphobic violence. Such points of view, though much rarer, are still expressed today. As surprising as it might sound, the total majority of my interviewees, even those of them who were already young adults in the late Soviet and early post-Soviet times, knew almost nothing about homophobic and transphobic practices in the milieu of police and penitentiary that were the most widespread in that time. Here I'm referring to so-called subotniks lists and lowering down ratio in prisons. And drawing on the classical example of Holocaust and post-Holocaust era, Jeffrey Alexander points out that the resilience and forgotten stage very often is shaped by multiple factors after crucial event that traumatized certain communities. And after the events have finished, the people who experience traumatic events attempt to charge themselves with a can-do mentality, trying to cut off the past from the present, while the younger generation of this community encourage them to go over the past, depreciating their traumatic experiences. Thus, such a stage can continue for several dozen years. However, in the case of Ukrainian queer people, such denial and forgetfulness of the systemic violence that have been done by the criminal justice system in the recent past has also an additional background. My interviews are ready to forgive the criminal justice system, its past and present practices of persecution in order to get protection from the police and penitentiary, because for them it particularly signifies recognition by the state and the criminal justice system of their vulnerability as a social group. And secondly, last but not least, it would signify that LGBTI plus community as a social group has become the subject of a legal relationship in the field of criminal law. And the third general narrative, which appears in this discussion, may seem more problematic, especially for scholars of queer studies and critical criminology. It is apparent that such an endeavor is a result of the attempt to reconcile queer identities with national identities and a feeling of belonging to the nation state. This aspiration requires victimized queer people to feel an ability and will of the nation state they feel they belong to protect and secure them. And in this way, they try to gain access to their sexual citizenship. This aspiration might be especially strengthened by the experience of everyday homophobia, heterosexism, and transphobia from a variety of institutions, collectives, and social groups. And in those settings, the strong self-identification of LGBTI plus people with a nation they feel they belong to, may be undermined and affected. And since Ukrainian queer people often feel what I would call the national identity disorder, in this situation, the appeal to an institution of the state, which on the one hand embodies the nation, I'm talking about the criminal justice system and the police, and on the other hand is expected to be understanding, loyal, accepting, rational, and educated as a counterweight to the aggressive, intolerant, archaic, dual, and obscurantist society, and is expected to protect and secure its LGBTI plus citizens, and thus to recognize their belonging to the nation state by its superior authority, the criminal justice system, seems to be the apparent step to restore the national identity. Moreover, the differences in the vision of the criminal justice system among queer people in contemporary North America and Ukraine show us how the imagination of the West and of the queer West in Ukraine contradicts to the excuse me, contradicts to the current queer politics and discourses in, for example, North American countries, because Ukrainian queer people mostly continue to carry an imagination of the queer West as a legally idealistic dream about law and order and protection of the criminal justice system, with a special emphasis on retributive justice rather than restorative one, while the perception of the legal and justice system among North American queer people has drifted into an anti-police resentment and denial of all the current criminal justice practices. Do I have one more minute? No. Yeah. Thank you. Maybe the last thing I would like to say, about the further research directions in this area. Once again, even though the very large part of leftist and queer social thought, social theory aims to abolish police, we have to understand that even though the police as an institution is inscribed in modern and capitalist society and in the capitalist and modern institution, the retributive justice itself is not. It has existed before and perhaps it will exist after. And so I would like to keep researching on how the queer community imagines the institutionalization or existence of the justice, restorative and retributive at the same time in, let's say, imagine post-police or after-police age. And I think here, the contextual differences between North America and Eastern Europe can be also interesting in terms of more comprehensive and nuanced vision and imagination of this social project. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Roman. That was an excellent summary of your chapter. And I like that you indicate some of the future research directions. I think that's really important. Without further ado, I will turn it over to Vitaly, who will give his remarks and then jump into the Q&A.
Sorry, my mouse decided to give up on me for a second as I was trying to unmute myself. Hello, everyone. I too would like to start by expressing my big thanks to Emily, first and foremost, for inviting me to contribute to this book project, for putting together such an outstanding volume and expertly shepherding it through publication, obviously to her and to everyone at the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute for organizing and supporting this event. It is very important that we have this panel as a part of the Institute series, and it is a very important step in recognizing the role of LGBTQ plus topics across the humanities and social sciences as part of research that is being conducted in the field of Ukrainian studies and its prominence. In my preface to the book, I tried to situate it in a larger context, both chronologically and disciplinarily, so that we could see where it fits. One ought to remember, of course, that even in the West, the field of LGBTQ plus research on the former Soviet Empire, the Second World, and is a very recent phenomenon. There were first attempts that date back to the mid-1970s, early 1980s, but they were very isolated attempts conducted by Western scholars, primarily in the United States. And also there were limitations as to what kind of research could be pursued simply because of what was accessible. So at the beginning, we have historical research, which is primarily conducted in the forms of compiling lists. So prove that, you know, queer people exist, that they existed in some form in the past. We recognize that modern LGBTQ identities, of course, are modern and a product of, you know, state politics and, you know, very much with, you know, Foucault's history of sexuality approach, that, you know, they are created as identities in the mid-19th century. And this is what historical research on both empires that divided Ukraine at the time, the Russian and the Habsburg, also demonstrates. And on the other hand, we have literary scholarship and scholarship on other arts like music, visual arts, cinema, which tries to identify and decode queer presence in texts, whether overt or covert. Very often it required these skills in reading between the lines, which of course everyone who was studying cultural production during totalitarian regime rules knows that reading between the lines is indeed an indispensable essential skill. And then what happened is as the Soviet Union was changing, as you know, perestroika was happening, and then shortly after that, after it collapsed, so in the very late 80s, early 90s, we had a sort of utopian period of discovery. On the one hand, we did have the domestic activists and the nascent scholars encounter Western paradigms, conduct dialogue with Western theory, and rethink things in very significant ways. Very often, this was indeed a reading experience. And here I would place the generation such as mine and of Oleksiy Yurchak, whom Tamar mentioned. We both arrived in the US academia as young students around 1989-1990, and both ended up at Duke University. I was then exchange student and then continued elsewhere. So thank you, Tamar, for representing Duke and also for mentioning you know, Oleksiy and another dear friend, the late Jose Munoz, who was also a graduate student at Duke at the time. So we have And Duke also, importantly, was also a place where dialogue was happening between Western, non-dogmatic left, and seeking and trying to identify representatives of non-Orthodox Soviet, non-dogmatic left in the post-Soviet countries, in the former Soviet Union, the former Soviet bloc. So sometimes there is a ferment of one particular place, even though, of course, it was not all just happening on the Duke campus in Durham, North Carolina. There were many other important places around the world where important research was being pursued. But yes, Duke played in that sense a very crucial part. But moving into the kind of discourses that were pursued in the 1990s, what is interesting is that from the very beginning of the serious development of this field, that is LGBTQ plus research on the Soviet Union, post-Soviet space, et cetera, we have self-reflexiveness and being careful about not to impose wholesale Western categories. In fact, scholars studying the region from the very beginning are exceedingly careful. And sometimes we have, however, the danger of almost utopian valuing the past attempts to negotiate a network and figure out one's own identities that were in some ways resistance to the system. So we see something similar to the old, very old fashioned, you know, anthropologists of studying the traditional societies of, say, Polynesia or other places and saying, wow, they're so cool, I want to be like them. And it required several different steps afterwards to rethink and challenge and problematize those assumptions. And this is something that I do discuss in the preface as well. And what is very important to me is then where we are chronologically and where we are disciplinarily in the evolution of the field. Because after that boom of the 1990s, early 2000s, there was a rupture, there was a break, there was actually no generational continuity for a while. And a lot of scholars in the field were worried that this was a one-time blip in research and it would not be pursued more further on, that somehow attention and interest and academic fashions moved elsewhere. And therefore, I think it's incredibly important that roughly in the last 10 or so years, we see a new surge of interest across many different disciplines in these topics, and that the field of LGBTQ plus research on the post-Soviet, you know, post-Soviet bloc areas of Eastern Europe, Eurasia, Caucasus, Central Asia is very robust. It is, has a large presence of a younger generation of scholars, and it's also disciplinarily very rich. So it stretches all across the humanities and the social sciences. And this book that Emily edited and which came out just recently followed on the tracks of two other books that came out in 2020, one of which was literature focused, and that was a result of a conference happened at the University of Ljubljana in Slovenia called Go East. And then the other one was primarily political science focused, and that is LGBTQ plus activism in Central and Eastern Europe, resistance, representation, and identity, co-edited by, again, a Ukrainian scholar, Marina Shevtsova, and Rajana Buyantujeva. And the Slovene book is, the editor is Andrei Zavrl and Aloysia Zupan-Sosic. So we have disciplinary diversity. We have a generational representation of a number of much younger scholars. And that to me is highly important. And we see the area being placed into a lot of larger networks and comparative paradigms, whether they are within Europe or whether they are international, which is why I think it's very important that we engage with post-colonial and decolonial approaches, and which is why it is very important to see the region not only vis-a-vis practices in the European Union and North America, but also elsewhere around the world. And that is why I think that a lot of very, very important contributions have been made here. And that's why I was thrilled to participate. In the interest of time, what I'm going to do now is wrap up my remarks, as we already have several questions that have been trickling in. And I would like to give voice to those questions, and then we will have the opportunity also, hopefully, for the panelists to engage with each other. But I propose that we move to the questions from the audience right away. And we have a first question from from Margarita Balmaceda, who actually has two questions, but I'll read the first one at the beginning. I haven't finished the book yet, but it seems that quite a few of the chapters in one or another way discuss the fact that LGBT movements adopted North American, Western European ideas and ideology, often uncritically, especially in the early 1990s. The introduction to the book also discusses this. On the other hand, there is the whole question of post-colonialism as a framework to understand the relationship between the Soviet Center, Russia, and some of the countries discussed in the book, for example, Ukraine or Kazakhstan. How do the two intersect? So Margarita's question actually sort of pivots a little bit to something that I was talking about, and that is uncritical adoption by the activists, not the scholars, but the activists of some of the Western ideas about LGBT movements, LGBT rights struggle, and so on and so forth. And the question of post-colonial, decolonial framework and approaches, and how do they work in the book? So, esteemed colleagues, who wants to try to say a few words about this?
I suppose I can start, but I'd love to hear Tamar and Roman's perspective on this as well. And I mean, I would just sort of start by saying that it was this topic that was part of the inspiration of the original panel, just thinking about the language that people were using, and this reflected the discussions that I was having in Ukraine with activists who maybe would publicly choose to use one term, but internally and amongst themselves were having these types of conversations. And so I think Vitaly, what you just said about the question between activists versus scholars is really important, because maybe at the same time that activists are recognizing that this discussion is important, it's really the scholars that are delving in and providing the kind of theoretical framework and background, because we know from both your preface and Tamar's introduction that this is not something that is only happening in this part of the world, right? This is a conversation that's been going on all over, and so we're really situating our examples, I think, within that trend. Interestingly, I think in this volume, some of the chapters that aren't about activism do highlight that pushback about and that framework of post-coloniality really well. And I think Margarita mentioned Jeanar's chapter from Kazakhstan, which is looking at Kazakh folklore. And I hope Jeanar won't mind me summarizing, paraphrasing her chapter a little bit, but looking at the ways that folklore was repressed by colonialist regimes, and that repression also resulted in the repression of queer and non-gender binary themes. Once we kind of move beyond that colonizing rhetoric, we actually create the space to see non-binary narratives and queer narratives that come out. And that chapter, of course, isn't about activism at all. And it is a scholarly look at something. But I think that finding places where this space has already existed is an important kind of decolonizing practice. But I'd like to hear from our other panelists too. So I'll stop there.
So I'll just jump in and say that. So while I think that there the idea of the uncritical adoption of categories, ideas, and forms of politics by activists was happening to a certain extent, I think what's also most interesting in my research on this is that it was never quite correct, right? It was always like there was this kind of space left between things. So the way in which, and one of the ways that I've thought about this is even the idea of what is liberal in the post-socialist world is different from what, you know, we might mean by liberalism in the US context. I remember also the LGBTQ, and this comes up in the volume in a number of places, right? Whether to use the Q or not. For a long time in Armenia, activists would often tell me that the Q stood for questioning, which I found really interesting. And questioning meant not knowing whether one was gay or not, but kind of thinking about how that is always a possibility. So it opens up a new way of even making sense of the word queer, I think, for us is, you know, the not quite knowing, but knowing something is off is where the questioning falls in. So it's not so much the uncritical adoption that I find interesting, but that the way of taking up things in ways that they were not necessarily entirely meant to be taken up that opens up new spaces of reflection.
I think I'm also expected to jump in. Thank you. Like, there is no much thing to add after Emily and Tamar, but I just would like to maybe a little bit reframe the question. I would like to ask in response, what does it mean, like, Western activism and Western vision? Because I think it would be very useful for, let's say, like, our decolonial thinking, if we start thinking, like, if we stop thinking about the West as a, like, whole something unique and the same everywhere, because let's say, like, I'm currently living and working in Quebec, which is a French-speaking province of Canada and kind of like country in the country, and let's say even in Quebec, that is, like, theoretically Western society, the LGBT movement, like, throughout 60s, 70s, 80s, have oppositioned itself to the values of the English-speaking world. And for them, they rejected any mainstream cultural discourses of the English-speaking world. And they tried to rather refer to, like, French experience, German experience, a Latin American experience, because for them, English-Canadian and American, English-North American queer experience has been foreign and, like, absolutely misunderstood. And I would say that it's probably just the question of the hegemony. Yeah, if we refer to Gramsci and hegemonic discourse that, after the Second World War, and especially, let's say, since, like, 60s, the global discourse on everything is dominated by United States, United Kingdom, and maybe English-speaking Canada a little bit. And it has become the center of the global knowledge production. And this is why perhaps such a domination is, to a certain extent, inevitable. It's not to say that it's good or bad. It's just, like, things happen this way because, before the Second World War in the 19th century, it was rather a French and German intellectual discourse that has dominated everywhere, right? Like, things change. But I would agree with the question that it doesn't enrich necessarily, and it doesn't strengthen the local activism and in Eastern Europe and Eurasia. And I think this was one of the aims and goals of our contributions to this volume. And I hope we would be able to advance this discussion.
Thank you so much, Roman. Actually, we have from Margarita Balmaceda a specific question to you as well. As Roman notes in his chapter, very few LGBT people decide to interact with the criminal justice system after being assaulted. This does not surprise me in the least, but are there any signs of change? He argues that focusing too much on the police may neglect other structural causes, but from a policy perspective, and Margarita is a political scientist, wouldn't it make sense to start with the police?
Thank you so much, Margarita. I think your comment doesn't necessarily deny my one. It's just, I think we're talking about different things a little bit. I didn't argue that it's not important or it's not necessary to reform police as an institution. I would rather talking about the construction of cultural trauma in queer community against the police and toward the police. Yeah, and this is why I have questioned, why do we assign, because the Alexander's theory questions the assignment of guilt and responsibility for certain institutions for the system of structural violence that has happened in the society, right? He refers to this universal example of Holocaust. Who is responsible for that? Was it like only Hitler or all the Germans? Was it all the just party members or all the Germans? What is that about like Catholics or Protestants? But the problem, whomever we assign responsibility to, and the problem stays the same, that in assigning the individual responsibility for certain social institution that was engaged in the structural violence, we step from the comprehension of how the structural violence happens and how it functions and how the society functions. We miss like the very important point in understanding how could we advance social justice and social progress. So that was about this discussion, rather about the neglection of the necessity of reforming and restructuring, let's say, police forces in the modern society.
Thank you so much, Roman. We have another question, which is from Roy Kimmy, and it has to do with the right-wing mobilization. And this is something that we discussed in this panel, that is discussed in the volume, the so-called anti-gender campaigns sweeping across much of Europe, especially Catholic Europe, but very much also, you know, now developing into non-Catholic countries within Eastern Europe and Eurasia as well. So his question is, could you say more about the national and transnational mobilizations against the ratification of the Istanbul Convention in Ukraine, Russia, but also throughout East Central Europe? Who would like to tackle the questions of, you know, right-wing mobilization and specific case of the Istanbul Convention, so gender equality, violence against women, and other issues that have become all of a sudden hijacked and hostage by those anti-queer right-wing mobilization narratives and practices?
I'll start. I know that Tamar has also published something recently, I think, about illiberalism. I remember this in the title of the article. So hopefully you'll have some more to say. I mean, So we know that Ukraine has recently ratified the Istanbul Convention. I would just say that first, and that's widely seen, I think, by activists, from a broad variety of activists as an important good step that goes along with some of the anti-discrimination legislation that Ukraine has signed. Again, the question recurs is about implementation. You know, how is this going to actually change things for people on the ground? And then, of course, this connects back to the question of police and what's the role of police in implementing these more public legislations. I would add, in my own kind of framing of this topic, I started in my research, I studied gender-based activism and feminism before I studied LGBT activism at all. And I think in kind of Western queer theory and Western feminist theory, we see these spheres as rather separate, but I think they get collapsed a lot in the region. And this is a prime example of this idea of a Western hegemonic narrative about what is threatening to the nation and the family and to traditional values. We see this same rhetorics about gender. They're collapsed into rhetorics about sexuality. So women who advocate for gender equality or people who advocate for feminist practices fall into the same category of threat as LGBT identified people in terms of what the external threat is. And that threat is coming from outside, right? It's coming from, I don't know where it's coming from, the glossed idea of what the West is, in which everybody is the same and you know, we're all throwing away our families because, you know, of our feminism, I guess. But I think, you know, and I these are common all over. So we've seen there's some really good research on the Stop Gender campaigns in Poland. There's some study of it in Russia as well. And we see it in Ukraine. You know, it's a lot of the anti-LGBT propaganda has the same rhetoric as anti-gender, anti-feminist propaganda. So I think what I think is interesting in that conversation is why these rhetorics, which are distinct, you know, they're not the same thing. It's not asking for the same protections. It's not asking for the same thing, but they become kind of collapsed as this like threatening ideas that come from the West. And that's a really important place where the West is created as this threatening idea that goes along with other conspiracy theories, I think. That we can see that's probably another conversation. But these are also easily really, you know, popularly mobilized by the far right at the same time that they're mobilized by certain political figures. And I think those intersect as well.
Yes, so absolutely. I think that there is a mobilization happening. There are connections and links between right-wing organizations in all of these different places. I mean, there's a lot of evidence that points to that. There's also evidence that points to the ways in which Putin is constructing a kind of Eastern Eurasian imaginary along with a bunch of right-wing thinkers that are with, you know, working with him on his own platform that lead to some of these more local instantiations of the same kinds of claims of threat. But I think it's especially in regard to the question about the Istanbul Convention in particular, it also points to how we have to be very particular within the work that we're doing in all of these different contexts, because there are very different reactions to some of these things. In Armenia, while the whole anti-gender movement came out of a 2013 law on equal protections and opportunities for men and women, which was referred to as the gender equality law, and the whole anti-gender movement then emerged from there, which was happening much earlier in Russia and Ukraine and Poland and Hungary and some other places. The Istanbul Convention was not necessarily part of that whole thread of communication. Rather, it was because it was called the Istanbul Convention, and so is associated with Turkey and thus the genocide. And so the threat was coming from this other place, even though all of that other gender conversations, you know, the way in which gender is trying to turn everyone into a transgender and all of that, that was very much also part of an anti-genocide or genocide recognition politics, which was supposed to be, you know, if Europe converts everyone to a homosexual or transgender, no one reproduces, and then there won't be any people in the future. And so Turkey's dream of eradicating Armenians from the planet will be achieved. The Istanbul Convention was not even touched on its actual content. It was purely on its title, the Istanbul Convention, Turkey is trying to commit genocide against us again. So I think that the relationship between that kind of global, which is a global as part of this other region in the world, not Western Europe, but in this case, Eastern Europe or Eurasia or whatever we might call it. But also the local, right? They're in tension, but they're also very much in conversation with one another.
All right. Thank you so much. Using my moderator privileges, there is a question that I wanted to ask the panelists, and that is where do we see positive examples happening in public spaces and, you know, public events? Emily, you talked about specifically the equality marches or pride parades, and it's important that, you know, in the Ukrainian case, actually they emphasize that this is an equality march. So this is not a festive event, that this is a human rights demonstration. We see this dynamic playing out a lot, and also the allyship, the fact that a lot of non-queer identified leftist activists support those events, and this is not unique to Ukraine. This has also happened elsewhere. Latvia, for example, which hosted EuroPride in 2015, that was very clear there how probably I think the majority of the marchers were non-queer identified themselves, rather than there were allies from the across the leftist spectrum who wanted to support this important cause. But what other public spaces, public events that show us this process of decolonization of local queer experience happening? Do we have these potential sort of sprouts of some sort of utopian future of equality and recognition? And I guess with this happy one, this will be the last question, after which we'll conclude our broadcast.
Yeah, thanks for that question. One thing, so there's been some increasingly good monitoring of LGBT related demonstrations in Ukraine, for sure, and in parallel attacks on those demonstrations and violence against LGBT identified people. So, but one trend that has been identified is increasing numbers of places that host LGBT plus demonstrations that are kind of part of this equality march, equality festival umbrella. And then in places where there has been a longer history of pride parades, there are more events that are about education of the population, that are creating community spaces where people can be involved. This is another aspect that I'd like to look at in my future research, is the different organizations that are supporting these types of events and how the cities, in particular the city governments, are or are not supporting the creation of those spaces. Just the fact, I think, that of the possibility of having different LGBT communities around Ukraine, where different people from different places, you know, can create their own spaces in the vision that they want, that's a really liberating potential, I think, in my mind, because you know, we know, and one of the, I mentioned the chapter on rural Latvia and the life histories of these gay male performers who use kind of rurality as part of their identity. I mean, we always assume that urban space is the place where queer identities are being developed and where queer spaces exist. And so, you know, the more that people in local spaces have the chance to create the communities that they want, I think that's a really positive and potentially liberating possibility.
All right, I guess with this, since we are already 2 minutes past our official allotted time, I would like to thank Emily once again for bringing us all together for this wonderful book project. So this is a great book that I recommend to everyone. And thank you to my fellow panelists. It's been wonderful to share the panel with you. And again, big thanks to everyone at the Ukrainian Research Institute at Harvard, especially to Christina and Megan, who expertly supported today's event. Thank you so much, everyone. This concludes our panel.
Thanks, Vitaly. Thank you so much to those of you who joined us today. Thank you so much to the other authors of the volume, whose hard work went into making such a wonderful book. And you can read a little bit more about the process of the publication online on HERI's website. And just to close, I'd like to invite you to two exciting events next week. If you have not yet tired of hearing from me, I will be speaking at an event on Monday, March 8th for International Women's Day. This is co-hosted by the Ukrainian Institute in London and the Temerty Contemporary Ukraine Program. That event is 30 years of women's activism in Ukraine. I'll be joined by Dr. Tamar Martinuk and Dr. Jessica Zachovich. We'll be talking, of course, about women's activism. That's at 1:30 p.m. Eastern Time on Monday. And HERI next week is hosting the Patrician Memorial Lecture by Dr. Yohanan Petrovsky Stern from Northwestern University. And his talk is entitled A Paradigm-Changing Day, Jews, Ukrainians, and the 25th Anniversary of the Babyn Yar. That'll be streamed on YouTube from 12 to 1:30 Eastern Time on Wednesday, March 10th. Thank you so much, everybody, for joining us.